there! Welcome to this episode of Keto Chat. I'm Carol Freeman, the creator of the Fast Track to Keto Success program. I'm here with Megan. She's going to share her story of keto over the last year, keto journey, and I'm really, really excited to have you here. So, Megan, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hi, my name is Megan, like she said, and I'm a massage therapist, and found Carol a year ago and started doing her program and have really found some great success with it, even though it's been a challenging journey and have had some bumps along the way, but it's been really beneficial and excited to share with you guys.
One of the reasons I'm so excited to have you is because it hasn't been the easiest journey for you, and you're so inspirational to people to just keep that long-term focus. We'll talk about that along the way, but so, when you started keto, what were your goals? Like, what did you hope it would do for you? What did you expect it would do for you?
Well, I think my ultimate goal definitely was weight loss. You know, you hear just weight loss.
Yeah.
And, but I found way more things happened during the journey. But ultimately it was weight loss.
Okay.
Just kind of feeling better. Felt really kind of sluggish, crummy, and, was hoping to find a new way of eating that wasn't so restrictive and kind of wearing you down. So
if you're like every other woman in the world that's wanting to lose weight, you probably tried a lot of things over the years.
Definitely tried lots of stuff.
What all had you tried before this?
Gosh, starvation, Weight Watchers, yeah, those were the main two, unfortunately. I tried eating healthy, know, the conventional, you know, lots of veggies, low fat, you know, those kinds of ways of eating, and also, like, working out a lot. Hi, sweetie.
Hey, he's not even on camera, but he's being very aggressive with pet people.
Yes.
Please pet me.
Lots of attention. But yeah, and like working out a ton and just kind of burn myself out.
Yeah. Because you're 31?
31.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So when do you remember like the first time you kind of felt like your weight was not what you wanted it to be? When did that happen in your life?
I think really in high school is when it hit me the most.
Okay.
Just not being able to do sports and be as active as I wanted to be, and just not looking like the other girls and fitting into the popular clothes. And again, 31, so Abercrombie and Fitch was a big thing back then.
Yeah.
So like not being able to fit into their clothes and just feeling really self-conscious about, you know, not being trendy.
Yeah, well, because those clothes are all about, like, two small clothes that show off every other little body part.
Yeah. A lot. Yeah.
So a lot of girls end up doing like really extreme things in high school to try to fit in. So what kind of things did you try?
Again, starvation was a big one.
Yeah.
So
just when you say starvation, like just, I'm not going to eat for a week or something like that, or?
Very, very small amounts of food.
Okay.
It wasn't like I would go days without eating, but it was definitely like I would skip a lot of meals. And then also limiting how much I would eat when I did eat. So it would be like this very dry sandwich with like two pieces of bread, like a piece of meat, very, very like waved the mayonnaise over the bread kind of thing. And then like veggies.
Okay.
How'd
that make you feel?
Exhausted.
Yeah,
I was so hungry all the time, just crabby. And it was really hard to focus too.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Did you kind of feel like, what's wrong with me? Like, why can't I?
Yeah, it was, you know.
Why can't I eat a wafer thin sandwich and be?
Right, and then watching my friends just eat lunch, and I was like, God, I really want to eat food and still lose weight. And I was doing, we called it body mechanics in school, but it was weightlifting. And so, I mean, we were doing exercise, and one of my good friends in that class, like, just rail thin, and she could just eat and work out and lift heavy, and it was just like, well, that's not happening for me.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah, I can imagine people watching are like, oh my gosh, I so identify. Mm-hmm. I've been there. Yeah. Yeah. And that's, you know, unfortunately, that's a place where a lot of people, they start their first, you know, feeling like their body's not the same as everybody else. And there's so much peer pressure to look exactly like the models and everybody else. And, but it's also a time when our hormones start to come on full force, and it really changes the way that our body looks. And
yeah. And I mean, so, and also at that time I was having some problems with my menstrual cycle and, was basically diagnosed with PCOS at that time. And so I was put on birth control. So that was also another issue.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Hormones.
Yeah. Basically. Do you mind sharing a little bit of like what kind of symptoms you were having of PCOS or?
I was having a major abdominal pain. Periods were extremely uncomfortable, cramps, heavy flow. Even though I've been diagnosed with PCOS, I've never not had a menstrual cycle. Okay. It's just always been a nightmare during that time. Extreme emotions, and then just all those the other symptoms that come along with it.
Yeah, and that is something that is becoming so common, unfortunately, these days for so many women. And most just think, like, and so what was the advice that the doctor told you? Put you on birth control pills, and then I know what they normally recommend, but what do they say?
Basically, like a low-fat diet. And
yeah.
You need to...
Yeah, lose weight. That's what they do. Low-fat, lose weight.
Mm-hmm. Which,
how does that really
work? It's so frustrating when you go to the doctor and you're like, just do these things.
Yeah.
You're like, okay, but I have done that, and nothing's happening. It's such a disheartening thing to hear.
Yeah, and I try that, and I feel tired and miserable and hungry all the time. Like,
yeah, and actually the birth control for me really messed up my body. I mean, I started having migraines, which I had never had before.
Wow.
And so they ended up, I was having these awful headaches, and they were like, well, when did you start birth control? And I was like, oh, I started this time. And I'm like, when did your headaches start? I'm like, oh, shortly after that.
Oh.
And so it was just like, oh, so then I went off birth control and like haven't had a migraine since. But birth control really messes you up. It doesn't fix you like the doctors say it will.
It's just not the cure all.
No.
And the whole prescription of eat low fat and lose weight didn't really work either, because that's most doctors still, that's all they know. Like, that's how you lose weight. You cut back on fat, you exercise more, you have portion control.
Yeah. And actually, when I was about 26, I went to my OB, and she was like, you know, you need to lose weight. And it was like, I had already gotten down to like 175 and was really active. Like, I was working out really hard.
Yeah.
Probably 2 hours a day, 5 days a week, and really limited, how much I was eating.
Yeah.
And then I gradually just started gaining weight back, and she was like, oh, you need to just lose weight. And she put me on a different birth control because I was still having some PCOS symptoms.
Yeah.
And so, and that was also the time that I was diagnosed with insulin resistance, which I had never heard of before until that time.
So they did testing with you for insulin levels, and did they do leptin at that time too, or?
No, so leptin was later.
Okay.
I was basically falling asleep at the wheel. It didn't matter how much I had slept at night. I mean, I basically would work 8 hours, and then come home and sleep and just sleep and wake up at 10, be like, oh, grab a bite to eat, and then go back to sleep and crash for the rest of the night.
Oh,
and then still just be exhausted during the day while I was at work. And then, I was about to start school. And so working full time and going to school is like, something's really wrong. I can't be this tired.
Yeah.
And went to a naturopath at Bastyr, and that's when I was diagnosed with leptin resistance.
Okay.
So
what did you understand about leptin resistance at that time? Probably a lot of people watching don't even really know what that is.
Yeah, that was the first time I had heard of it as well. And there's not a whole lot of information out there on it.
Mm-hmm.
And so basically the information I got was from the naturopath herself, and nothing against her. I felt like the test was really beneficial. It was
mm-hmm.
nice to know that there was something else going on, that mm-hmm. there's something happening that's really outside my control
mm-hmm.
at that time. And basically she put me in, it's called the ABC diet. I think I showed it to you.
Yes. When you first started with me, you brought in your prescribed leptin reset diet, and basically was a, you know, a very restricted, low fat,
yeah,
lower calorie rotational diet, and mm-hmm. and I was like, Megan, you poor thing, I'm so sorry that you're yeah. trying this, because that's another recipe. It's the same whole thing of like low calorie, low fat. It just makes you hungry and tired and miserable, and it doesn't fix any of that, unfortunately.
I was always hungry. And she's like, you can eat as much as you want. And I was like, okay. So, I mean, I'm eating like tons of lettuce, which is great, but it's still like, there was no fat to like help give you that satisfaction that full feeling.
Yeah. And we know now that it actually, to get leptin to work right and to reset leptin resistance, high fat is really important. So for those of you that don't know what leptin is, leptin is a hormone that helps us feel full and satisfied. So the way that it's supposed to work is that, let's say you're just going along at whatever weight you are for 10 years of your life. And then one day Thanksgiving comes along and you just eat more than you should. Your body puts on a little bit of fat, and then that extra fat releases something called leptin, the hormone that suppresses appetite until those fat cells go away, and then your appetite is normal again. So it's basically, it's what's supposed to help regulate your weight so that it stays exactly the same and that you don't overheat. However, we get this state of insulin resistance on top of it, where it overrides our body's ability to regulate its weight in a normal way. And then we, then because you keep gaining weight and eating more, then you develop also leptin resistance. So your fat cells are still releasing leptin, but the other cells that are supposed to listen to that signal start ignoring it because there's too much of it. And so then you don't get that normal appetite regulation that happens normally when you eat more than your body needs. Your appetite is suppressed and you're not as hungry. But when you get leptin resistance on top of insulin resistance, your body's gaining weight and you're still really, really hungry all the time.
Hungry. Yeah.
Yeah. And there's nothing that makes you feel satisfied except. Yeah.
Except.
Yeah. So, let's see. So how did you even hear about keto? I think it was your mom, right?
Like, yeah. So originally it was my mom. There's a gal in Seattle and she does, kind of a combo of, nutrition as well as, like psychology and counseling mm-hmm. kind of thing. And she had found, the ketogenic diet and did her research and found that it was really beneficial for people who have seizures. And she was like, you know, to my mom, Darcy, do you want to give this a try? And so I was like, you know, because she's going through the same thing of like, mm-hmm. nothing's working. And I was like, you know what? What the heck? We got one more try.
Yeah.
And so she tried it. And so we bought the Jimmy Moore mm-hmm. book. I can't remember the name right now.
Keto Clarity. Yeah.
Keto Clarity, yes. Yeah. And we read the book one summer. Most of the book, it's a very beneficial book as far mm-hmm. as knowledge and kind of the science behind mm-hmm. the ketogenic diet. But if that's your first stop, it's extremely overwhelming mm-hmm. because it's kind of hard to understand. Okay, so I read all this stuff, but what do I do?
Yeah.
And
what do I have for breakfast?
Yeah, and I mean, like, there's like recipes and meal plans in the mm-hmm. back, but it's still overwhelming mm-hmm. Because there's so much information thrown at you, and it's like, okay, well, can I eat 5 eggs and just bacon every morning? Like, are there other options? Mm-hmm. You know, like, what about my meals for the rest of the day? You know, so we tried it, and unfortunately we thought that cheese was a fat, mm-hmm. which is not true. And so just wasn't seeing the results or like kind of feeling good mm-hmm. while we were doing it. And so my mom had done lots of more research as far as like other people who were in the kind of the ketogenic world. And I'm not exactly sure how she stumbled on you, but I'm really glad that she did.
Yeah, well, it was a referral from
the
nutritionist she was seeing. Yeah, because her and I went to school together.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I basically broke down in tears because it was so frustrating of feeling this crummy and wanting a change but not knowing how to do it. Mm-hmm. And basically it was a gift from my parents to do your program. And really, it's the best gift ever.
Yeah. Yeah, and at that time, so you got to do a special version of my program that I did live in person, and we met for like 14 weeks, every week together. Yeah. It was really cool. I don't have that offering anymore, so that's very special.
You got special. To
yes. Yeah, so, and I know, like, the group of women that were in that were all, it was serendipitous that you were all together, because you were all very insulin resistant, probably all leptin resistant, and you got to support each other through a very challenging process, because a lot of people hear about keto and they hear about the people that lose weight really easily, right? Because that's what, that's what stands out to people, is that they see like people posting in Facebook groups and on YouTube videos, and then they even look at the results that I got, that, you know, I lost quite a bit of pounds my first month even. And people have this fantasy, they think that that's what they should get, like that's what keto does. But the truth is that it just depends on how much healing has to go on in your body before your body's ready to release that extra weight. And for some people, it takes a long time of ramping up and healing and reversing that insulin resistance before the weight starts to come off. And it can be a slow process. And so, especially if people have the fantasy that, like, I'm going to lose 30 pounds in the first 30 days, and then they don't, and maybe they don't even lose any weight for the first couple of months or longer, a lot of people get really frustrated, and you think, this isn't working, I'm going to give up and go back and eat cakes and donuts. And it's like, oh, so much of what, you know, there, I would say probably, I don't know, 20 or 30% of the women that I work with are in that same boat. Okay. That they have to have a lot of patience. Mm-hmm. And so you all happen to be in the same boat, and it was actually really good, because probably if one person would have been losing weight really easy in that group, everybody else would have gave up.
Yeah.
Because you were all there, and you were all,
looking at each other.
You all had the same, you know, same journey that, mm-hmm. that during that 14 weeks, I don't think any of you lost really any significant amount of weight.
I think maybe a total of 5 pounds.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. And so we had to really look at, noticing all the other benefits that you were getting and how much better you were feeling. So share, you know, share with us, share with them, with me, you know, what were some of the benefits that you started to notice? Like, what was it that really kept you going despite the scale not doing what you wanted it to do?
Yeah. So, the one thing that you had started the program with was, you know, like writing down things that, you don't like, like how you currently feel. And so it really actually was like, oh, sit down and really figure that out. Mm-hmm. And one thing that I noticed was in the morning, especially, when I would get up to get ready, my ankles were extremely stiff.
Yeah.
Like I felt like a 90-year-old person trying to get out of bed and trying to get things moving. And it was actually really painful on top of being stiff. Mm. And that was one of the first things I noticed went away. And that, now I can get out of bed and there's no problem. I just go. So that was one of the first things that I noticed. And then, obvious menstrual cycle, way easier.
Okay.
Don't have, the mood swings like I did. Cramps are way more manageable. It's not that big of a deal anymore. It's just like, oh, it's another week, you know? So, and then, I am not hungry like I used to be.
Yeah.
I feel satisfied when I eat. And I can go to parties and functions, or just even going out shopping, whatever it may be, and not have to be like, what am I going to eat? What am I going to do? Like, I'm going to be hungry, you know, anything like that. It's, I can go out and I can go and do things and not be fixated on food. I mean, really, it was kind of like being an addict of, when am I going to get my next fix? When am I going to get my next meal? And now it doesn't feel like that at all.
It's total freedom. Like, you know, some of you watching this maybe have never experienced that. I was the same way. Like, you know, if I was going to go somewhere or leave the house, it was like, okay, I need to think about, like, should I take some food with me? Where are we going to stop? How long till I can eat? Because it was just food and hunger were always on your mind. And it was just, It was a compulsion, and it was based on the biological stuff going on. It wasn't really, you know, like, oh, just stop thinking about food. You know, it was really
drink a glass of water.
Yeah, exactly. Go for a walk, paint your nails, yeah. Right? It really was driven by the hormones that are going on in our body. And so that's one of the universal things that I see with people on keto that come through my program is they get that gift of freedom. And they no longer feel like they're enslaved to their appetite and hunger all the time. And it's like you're hungry and you're like, oh, I guess I should eat something. Mm-hmm. It's an afterthought rather than like 99% of what you're worried about and thinking about all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And for those of us who have been there, it is so freeing. Like just that benefit alone, I think it's worth it. A lot of people say
it
is.
Yeah, definitely. Also, like I had said before, I had gotten down to 175 and I was working out a lot. And at the time it was kind of like you have to work out. It's punishment. Mm-hmm. Like because you got fat, now you have to work out and that's your punishment for your current state. And now, it's fun to work out and I get to challenge myself. And, I mean, I don't recommend it right away, but like fasting workouts, mm-hmm. it really fun to see like how far I can push myself and I haven't had anything to eat, you know, all day or whatever. Yeah. And, like I'm running again and it doesn't hurt to run. I was having a lot of knee pain when I was running prior. And now I don't get those pains. And, I think we had talked about during your housewarming party that like I can run and I don't feel like I'm constantly heaving for breath. Like it's kind of like just going for a brisk walk and like, that's how heavy my breathing gets. And my heart rate comes right back down. You know, like it's just been amazing to work out again. It's been enjoyable instead of a punishment.
Yeah.
It's a treat.
You get your body's actually got plenty of energy and fuel to do it. So it's actually, you know, it's the way that our bodies are designed to work. Rather than, you know, when we're in the mode of storing fat, insulin resistance, our body can actually access the fuel that it's got.
Yeah.
And it turns out when it's running on fat, when you're running now, like it actually makes it so you don't have to breathe very much. And it's a very odd thing. Like
it
I remember the first time I got on a treadmill that I was really, truly keto adapted. And I'm like walking at a really brisk pace and I'm not breathing any harder than if I was just sitting down. And I'm like, this is really weird. Like, because it used to be that I would get breathing pretty hard just, you know, going up and down the stairs.
Right.
And I hadn't, you know, and it wasn't because I was like really, really fit now. Mm-hmm. I hadn't even been working out except for walking most of the time
when
I first started keto. So to get on that treadmill the first time and I'm walking as fast as I can and I'm just not even breathing, it was like, this is weird.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now I understand the science behind it. And then the, you know, last couple times I've gone hiking, it's also a weird sensation for me. So I used to love to go hiking because of the exertion and how it made my body was working really hard and
like
breathe hard and stuff. And this is the weirdest thing, but the last time I went hiking, it was just too easy and I wasn't breathing hard the whole time and it lost that thrill for me. It was really weird. I'm like, I thought I loved hiking and now I don't care anymore.
I have to look at nature.
I know. I'm going to have to figure out I'll have to try again a bit later. But it was like, it was really weird because it wasn't that like high from the exertion. It was just like the same as if I walked down to the mailbox or something.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, I got to figure out a different way to push my body farther, I think.
Because so my trainer, there's this class. And so you have to, you know, to hit certain target heart rates. And she came to like check in and see how I was doing. And I was supposed to be in my hardest heart rate zone, which I was breathing heavy, but I could still carry on the conversation with her. And she was just kind of like, are you sure? And I'm like, no, I'm at 160. You know, like, I'm good. And she's just like, what? And so it was just really kind of funny for her to see also like, here I am, I've got my heart rate up. Yeah. You know, I am exerting myself, but I can still kind of have a conversation. And
that used to be the way that maybe not used to be, it is the way they kind of used to judge your heart rate was, could you talk?
Can you talk?
Conversation. Yeah. But it turns out that when you're actually using fat as your primary fuel, it needs less oxygen to process it.
Mm-hmm.
And so you don't have to breathe as much. So
yeah.
There's something weird going on with your body.
Yeah. And I think also, as you know, being a massage therapist, you know, like it's a physically demanding job.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, not trapped, but I'm in a room with somebody for an hour and I can't snack. I can't, you know, there's a lot of things that I can't do. It's that hour's for them. Mm-hmm. And, now it can truly be about them for that hour. I'm not thinking about, you know, like, am I going to eat after this? Am I hungry during this? Yeah. And also like with working out, it's awesome to feel strong and to bring that to my work. And it's, I think, changed my job as well.
Yeah. Cause I know for most massage therapists, it's like your day is slam packed and you rarely even get a break, you know, to shove something in your mouth.
Yeah.
Now it sounds like it's just freedom. You can just do the work and really
give yourself I work for a solid 5 hours and like, I really don't have a break and, I'm able to just, you know, full 5 hours and I ate probably 3 hours prior to that. And then I go home and it's like, I'm not quite hungry yet. You know, like I'm still not thinking like, when's my next meal?
Take us back to like when you were first starting keto, the way that I taught you how to do it. Like what was it like wrapping your mind around going from, you know, all these trials you'd had of low fat eating to, and I remember you had some great things you do with like, you know, you take a piece of cheese and put butter on top of it.
Like a grilled cheese sandwich.
What was that like? Like doing that 180?
Well, at first you kind of feel like you're cheating because you're like, oh, I get to eat all this fat and it's all this like rich, just amazing food that you'd like, before you'd look at it, you'd be like, oh, that looks really good.
Yeah.
But I can't have that because that's not low fat and that's going to just, you know, my waistline is just going to expand. And, it was kind of like, I felt like I was doing something wrong, almost, you know, but it was kind of fun to play around with too, as far as like, you know, how can I best incorporate fat into my diet? Mm-hmm. And,
Well, I know you and your mom had a few challenges, you know, a few weeks in. You had some family gatherings where you went away for the weekend.
Yeah, we had a lot of going away weekends.
Yeah, so you guys, I know you came up with some good strategies for navigating that, but then you also had an experience, I remember, that was not very pleasant. I don't know if you remember the one where you didn't quite take enough fat with you, and it was quite a miserable experience.
I think that was her. But yeah, it was really nice to do it with my mom because we had each other to kind of like, well, okay, so this is what I'm struggling with this week. This is what I've noticed that it's worked really well for me this week. And it was nice to have that on top of our conversations with you and just having that support of two people doing this, because it can be kind of challenging when the rest of the family is kind of looking at you like, or your friends even like, I feel like this is really extreme what you're doing. And, you know, but it's, like, just let me process this. Mm-hmm. And, the weekends that we would go away, we would definitely sit down and kind of meal plan as far as like, okay, what's our plan of attack? So that we're not stuck in a situation where we're really hungry and there's things around that are not going to be good for us on our keto journey.
Yeah.
And so, we would definitely sit out and bring out your book and go through, you know, like your meals. And because I think that was the other thing that was really successful, is that your meals are super quick and easy, that you can literally grab something really quick and you're fueled.
Yeah.
You don't have to worry about all the sugary sweets and other things that are around.
Well, it makes it easier to pack stuff to go away for the weekend too, right?
Yeah. And actually we would go away and a lot of our friends were like, well, that looks really good. And we're like, yeah, it's
really good actually. When you guys came up with some really great casseroles, it's one of the ones that I make now for guests. I just made it this last weekend. We had like all the women in my family got together and we made vision boards. And so, so I made
the breakfast casserole,
Breakfast casserole from Maria Emmerich's cookbook, the ketogenic cooking cookbook, I think is what it's called. I would have never made that had you guys not like raved about how good it was. And I've made it several times now and everybody just loves it. They're like, oh my gosh, it's so good. And
it's amazing. Yeah. I even had a friend and I made it for her and she was like, oh my gosh, this is really good. And she wanted the recipe to cook for her mom.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a little labor intensive, you know, just, there's a lot of steps. It's not like there's a ton of work. It's just, there's a lot of steps. And so like meal plans for the week, you know, it was easy for us to just do that casserole. And then that was, you know, a good week plus worth of breakfast. this. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have to worry about it. And so, I mean, there are benefits to the cookbooks as far as, like, just new ideas and mm-hmm. something new to try and kind of give you that, kind of that sensation of having that normal food, you know, the typical diet food, but that's still satisfying and keto friendly. So, but yeah, that's one of our favorites.
Basically. Yeah. I mean, that's just one example of, you know, people are afraid that, like, oh, I'm going to go to this family event or friends or something. And, you know, what am I going to take that I can eat? And the thing is, the food is so decadent and rich and high fat and delicious that whatever you take, like, everybody there who's not following keto is going to eat it. They're like, oh my God, can I have the recipe? This is so delicious. Like,
yeah.
Because it's all those foods that our bodies actually naturally recognize, the high fat that we need and our body yeah. likes. And it's got all these nutrients that we've been missing for so long because we've been avoiding fat forever. And
yeah.
and so people are afraid that, like, you know, yeah, if you just took a plain salad with no dressing, yeah, everybody's going to be like, that looks delicious. But if you take, you know, a casserole that's ham and eggs and cheese and cream cheese and sausage and more cheese on top of yeah. it, like, who's not going to like that? Except yeah. the vegetarians.
Yeah, and in fact, we made it for a baby shower, and yeah, yeah, everybody's like, this is really good.
Yeah. Yeah, they don't miss the, you know, noodles in there at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So that's a fun recipe there. So, so now something else that you talked about too is the quick and easy and how that makes things really doable. Now, have you noticed any difference in, like, before, did you want to spend a lot of time cooking and planning? Were you more interested in food before? Has that changed at all? Or,
I mean, I enjoy cooking. There's something fun about cooking and cooking for my family. But there's something also really freeing about
yeah.
not having to meal plan, not yeah. having to have things necessarily, like, prepared and cooked mm-hmm. ahead of time. You know, because I can make a lettuce boat sandwich in no time flat, and mm-hmm. I'm ready to go.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is really freeing. And mm-hmm. so, yeah, there are times where I'm like, oh, there's so many other things that I can go and do, and I don't have to worry
yeah.
about.
Here comes one more kitty. Well, that's one of the keys I've found. So I've identified, like, six, I call them my six pillars to keto success. So one of the things I've really identified as really key for people being able to do keto long term is having the ability to throw together a meal really fast, you know, and even no cook meals if possible. Mm-hmm. And it's because that's what people's lives are like. Like, most people spend very little time on meal prep. They kind of have their go-to meals that they always eat, or they go through, you know, fast food, or they stop at the grocery store or whatever. And so being able to, you know, instead of forcing people suddenly to spend a lot of time meal planning and cooking and forever the rest of their life, it's never going to happen. And so
yeah.
Figuring out a way, and I've you know, got the meal formula I teach people. So I don't think I mentioned this, but how long have you been doing keto now?
It's been a little over a year.
Okay.
So we started January of last year.
So you've got that foundation now that you know how to put together a perfect keto meal. You don't yeah. have to weigh and measure anything. You don't have to track your macros, right?
No.
Yeah.
No. In fact, I don't really think about food the way I did before. Like, I really just eat.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm hungry and I eat. And, yeah. I know, you know, like, okay, those are keto items that, you know, that's what we keep in the house. Mm-hmm. And that's what is around. So it's like, I can have anything, you know,
yeah.
and it's just, and you can get creative with it. And, you know, sometimes yeah. it's not super hungry, but, you know, I need a little something, a little pat of butter, you know, like, butter's my chosen pet.
Butter's your friend. So, oh, that's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. I've seen a lot of people, like, on Facebook, and they're doing, like, the Beachbody or whatever, and I see they have, like, all these groceries lined up, and it's all raw, and they have to process it. And
yeah.
I'm like, that sounds so exhausting. All those dishes. Thank you.
Right, because they're eating, like, five or six times a day or something, or
yeah, and, like, yeah. they have all these, you know, they have to have all these Tupperwares, and,
yeah.
you know, like, they're,
oh,
it's
yeah.
just, like, insane, and, yeah, I'm really grateful that I don't even have to, think about it. It's
yeah.
just, like, you just go to the grocery store once a week, and
yeah.
have stuff, and you're good to go.
Very freeing.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Because there's so many other fun things to do in life, except for
yeah.
thinking about food and grocery shop and prep food.
Yeah. Nice. So. Nice. Well, so let's talk about your transformation then that you've had over the last year. So you said, you know, during our 14 weeks of work together, you maybe saw about 5 pounds loss.
Yeah. So,
which would have discouraged a lot of people, but.
Oh yeah. And it was discouraging, but I think that, you know, doing your workbook of definitely thinking about the other benefits, mm-hmm. because there are so many other benefits to eating a ketogenic diet versus, just losing weight. So, it's been kind of a mental thing too for me, to change my way of thinking, because it could be very easy for me to say like, I've only lost 30 pounds this year, but that's really good, you know, considering I have leptin resistance and insulin resistance and, you know, like there's a lot of things that I have to repair in my own body for the weight to eventually come off. And so I feel like 30 pounds is a great thing.
Well, and the other thing is that you're going to, well, maybe we'll take a picture of this and post pictures so people can actually see it, but you have some really awesome things to share that you actually lost more than 30 pounds. Like the scale changed 30 pounds.
Yes.
But people get so hung up on like the scale. What is a scale weigh? It weighs what your entire body weighs. You don't want to lose.
Relationship with gravity.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, the best way to lose weight, go chop a leg off. You'll lose like 50 pounds right over.
Yeah.
But you don't want really just to lose weight. You want to lose fat. You want to gain muscle and you want to gain bone density actually. Cause as women, we especially need to protect our bones and not get osteoporosis. So, you have a gym that has this way of actually giving a really thorough, body analysis. Tanita, what it's called.
Yeah.
Right?
So I have my results from, so we do, it's called a fall challenge or spring challenge at the gym. And so, the first time I did this, body analysis was back in April. And so this year has also had a lot of like stressful events. And so one of them was I did hurt my wrist and ended up having surgery. And so I couldn't work out. At that time, but so I just did the scan, and so what it said was that I was 255 and that my fat mass was 124.2 pounds and my fat free mass, so my lean mass, my muscle was 130.8, which I mean, my lean mass, that's pretty good, you know. So
yeah,
and then it has a bunch of other stuff on here. And so, but it was nice to see, just kind of like a starting point, because still at this point, I've lost 5 pounds.
Right.
According to the scale.
Yeah.
And so, so over this, year, I eventually started being able to work out again and, lifting weights. And, so then I decided to do the fall challenge, which started in October. And I had gone down to 237.8 from 255. And my fat-free mass went down to 112.2. So that's a huge change from 124.2.
Yeah, so that's 12 pounds of fat loss. Yeah.
But I also lost some lean muscle. And so I had some conversations with my friend and trainer. And she's like, I think you need to bump up your protein. Because I'm working out really hard.
Yeah.
I have a physically demanding job. And so it was just like, for me, I needed to kind of increase my protein. And I was really hungry also. And so I think that's the other thing is that you start to, it's easier to start listening to your body and your cues. And so, like one of the gals on your Facebook was talking about like, I crave protein. It's like, okay, add fat, like see if that helps you with your cravings. And, so then it was like, okay, so I added fat instead of increasing protein and it still just wasn't enough. And so that's why I was like, okay, maybe I do need to increase my protein and see if that helps.
Yeah, definitely. Like if you're working out hardcore, then, more protein is appropriate. So
So that was, it's nice because she also likes the ketogenic diet. So, I mean, that's also a benefit to having my friend and trainer is that she sees the benefit in this way of eating as well. And not the conventional low fat. And so then, 10 weeks later, got on this scale, machine again. And, the scale had only changed by 2 pounds.
Okay. So at first you're like,
So for 10 weeks, I've been working my butt off. Yeah. And, I mean, I'm going to the gym 3-4 times a week, plus 4 to 5 hours of massage a day. Yeah. So, I mean, I'm working really hard. And so, and I'm, you know, I've increased actually how much I'm eating completely, you know, like increased how much fat and protein. And so, so it's still frustrating to see like only 2 pounds. But, my fat mass went from 112 to 105.
Seven pounds of fat loss. Yeah.
And, I increased my lean mass 5 pounds from 225 to 229.
Amazing.
129. So, yeah, I mean, so it, unfortunately, not all of you will have access to this kind of machine and this kind of data for yourself. But it's, I think that this is an important way to see, like, the scale lies to you. Because there's so much other things going on.
Well, and most trainers will tell you can either lose fat or you can gain muscle. You can't do them both at the same time. And you absolutely did both at the same time. And that's one of the things we're seeing with keto is that it preserves and even can bulk up muscle mass at the same time that you're losing fat. So, so please, those of you out there that are so frustrated with the scale, but your pants are getting looser.
Your pants are the best measuring tool.
Jimmy Moore has this phrase that he says, the scale is a lying liar that lies. And I totally agree with that because it doesn't tell what's going on behind the scenes. And we'll show a picture in here of Megan's before and after. And it's so dramatic. Like I asked her when she showed me, you know, only 30 pounds, right? You look at this and, you know, you swear she's lost close to, I don't know, 70 or 80 pounds is the way the body changes. And I was like, are those even the same pants? Like the after picture, the pants look like they're like super loose, like pajama pants.
Yeah.
And the first ones are like, you know, super tight like yoga leggings. Pants.
Yeah.
She's like, yeah, those are the same pants. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like huge difference.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was part of why I did my before and after pictures. Yeah. I wanted to keep the same clothes just to see like, cause I mean, you throughout your journey, you buy new clothes, get rid of old clothes, you know, what have you. And so to see the transformation within the same clothes, I think was important for me to see, just because the scale wasn't moving. Yeah. And so I think I needed that visual of what do I look like before and after.
Well, and it's tricky too, because most of the clothes that we wear, or most people wear most days are stretchy. And so it's hard to tell like, well, my pants don't feel any looser. Well, yeah, cause they're still stretchy. Right. And so, I can imagine too, even week to week in your pants, you weren't quite sure if those pants were
getting bigger. We had actually talked about when we were in the program, so as a massage therapist, you have a holster that holds your lotion. And so that was kind of my measuring tool during that time was I had to keep cinching up that holster that I wear around my waist because I was losing weight. And so it was like, I had to keep making it tighter so it wouldn't fall down and, you know, so,
Do you ever have moments where you're like, is this thing getting stretched out? Like,
yeah, well, at first I was like, what's wrong with it? Like, why do I have to pull on it so much more than I used to? But I was like, oh, things are changing. So
get rid of the scale if you can. Do some measurements. Even if you can't, if you don't have access to some kind of a body assessment measurement like this, is take measurements. I recommend taking measurements once a month for measurements. I also recommend taking photos once a month as well, and then comparing those. Because even if you're seeing loss on the scale, our brain has this weird thing where it'll say, like, well, I don't even know. Like, maybe the scale says I lost 10 pounds, but I'm not even sure I look any different. And you can see those photos, and you can compare, and then you'll be like, okay, this really is changing.
I mean, you see yourself every day in the mirror, and so it's kind of hard to, you see yourself, like you see the change every day, but it just doesn't register.
Right. Like, it's kind of like and after, for those of you watching that have kids, like you see them every day and then it's like you see a photo of them. You're like, oh my gosh, they've changed so much. Well, maybe that's different nowadays because people take photos so much of their kids all the time with the phone. They don't see the difference. But back when my son was young, we had to actually send them off. We took them to Costco to get developed.
Yes.
And you got doubles so that you had some to give away. So,
exactly.
Yeah, total side note there. So, all right. So.
Well, and I think also just real quick, you had talked about bone mass.
Yeah.
So being 31, you know, is it 30 or is it?
Well, yeah, I mean, they say, whoever they are, they say that as women or even as men, you can't gain, that you gain maximum bone density by 30. And from there on out, you're going downhill and there's nothing you can do. You can try to maintain bone density, but you can't gain any more bone density is what, you know, I was trained at school and, mm-hmm. you know, what the, I don't know who the authorities are of that, but that's, you know, what the studies have shown.
Yeah. And so, my bone mass was 6.4 pounds and it went up to 6.6. I mean, like, not a huge thing, but yeah. It's still really good. It shows that, you know, that can't change. It is.
Right. Yeah.
It is fluid. Like you.
Yeah. Well, and change. I, you know, I haven't seen any research on this related to keto, but knowing what affects bone metabolism. So in order to get minerals into our bones, we need the fat soluble vitamins. And guess what? We've been on a low fat diet for 40 or 50 years now, or trying to be. And we have an epidemic of osteoporosis in this country. I don't know if epidemic is the right word, but we have too much osteoporosis, right? Yeah, it's a problem. And, okay, so women try to eat a low-fat diet, so they're not getting these vitamins that they need to get the minerals in their bones. So it makes a lot of sense that if you start to eat a diet that's high in fat, that has plenty of these fat-soluble vitamins in that, then all of a sudden the minerals can actually get into your bones. And so I've encouraged some of my clients to think about that as well, although it's hard for them. So the scale's not changing. You could also be getting denser bones, and that's a really good thing because low bone density as we age is a huge risk factor for early death. So
yeah,
so that's excellent.
Yeah.
Yeah, I appreciate you sharing that. That's really cool. And hopefully that gives... you know, somebody out there or multiple people, you know, some inspiration, some hope, some long-term focus. So, what are your tips? You kind of said some things that you've done along the way that really helped, but I wonder if you, you know, want to share in a concise way or like bullet point way maybe, or, you know, kind of your tips for maintaining that long-term focus and not getting frustrated and giving up.
Yeah, well, so I will say also, you know, the holidays were hard. You know, I think everybody mm-hmm. struggles around the holidays, and I did veer a little, but I, again, listening to your body, it was like, I felt really crappy when I ate that, you know, those sugary sweets, and it's hard when you have patients that want to give you stuff. And so, like, you know, I would just, for the most part, put them out for, you know, my coworkers to eat, but, you know, like, I still took a little bit, but mm-hmm. it was amazing. Like, oh, this doesn't feel good. And so I think, you know, like we said, don't focus on the scale, you know, things are changing and you have to have that faith that they're changing. And it's, mm-hmm. it's a mental thing as well. You know, like you have to change your way of thinking about your journey.
Mm-hmm.
And then listening to your body and recognizing that, like, yeah, you feel better when you eat fat and you feel satisfied and you're not hungry. It's just not the last minute.
Well, and I think, you know, your example of, you know, in the holidays and you indulged a little bit in this and that or whatever, like, it's a really... It's a big testament to how different your body works now,
mm-hmm.
That you've healed a lot of that behind the scenes stuff that was going on before. And, you know, that's what I found is that if people can maintain, you know, more of a strict keto for quite a while, then occasionally having those things, doesn't completely derail you like they used to.
Right. Yeah.
Because you can notice such a big difference in how you feel and you really liked feeling so good. So then it doesn't end up being like a compulsion thing that you just go down that path and you can't get off of it again. But
right. Yeah. We've talked about that, like that addictive part of your mm-hmm. brain, you know, sugar totally plays a role in that. And I did notice that it was like, after I did indulge, it was like, I want more. That didn't feel good. You know, like, so it was that tug of war in your brain again, mm-hmm. of like, you don't feel good when you eat that way, but your sugar is like, oh, but but I want that again.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, you have to still work at it. That's mm-hmm. why I don't suggest veering. But yeah, so it definitely has changed a lot mm-hmm. in that regard of like, yeah, you can slip up, or you can, you know, indulge a little bit, like you said, and but it's easier to get back on that path when you've been doing keto for a while.
If you try to do it in the beginning, though, it's really hard to get.
Like Carol said, just not, don't even use the, like the stevia, the things that you, that don't change your insulin, when you eat them. Don't do that in the beginning. You know, like definitely kick that craving, in the beginning. And I think that will be like a big part of success as well.
So yeah. Yeah.
You don't turn to those as like a kind of a coping mechanism, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. So what you're talking about is like in the beginning, don't try to recreate all your former high carb favorite foods in keto form, because all it does is reinforce those old eating habits. And so taking a pause from that and retraining, you know, still finding really quick and easy things to eat, but finding things that are, you know, I'm trying to remember who it is that says, I think it's Brian Williamson that says, like, if you're going to eat keto, just eat keto. Like, don't try to recreate your former life. Like, that's one of the keys to success as well. And then occasionally, you know, if you want to have some keto dessert or something like that, it's fine. But it's not something that you're trying to obsess about and recreate everything. Right. So.
And actually, a lot of those desserts and the recipes are extremely labor intensive, and it's almost just not worth it.
Oh my gosh, I feel so much the same way now. So I used to, you know, call myself a foodie, consider myself a foodie, and I would spend a lot of hours, like any free time I had, I would be cooking elaborate things for my, you know, my son, my family, friends, you know, dinner party, whatever. And I have almost zero desire to do that now. Like, anything that takes more than 5-10 minutes to make is like, oh, like I could be doing so much more stuff. Like, it just is not a desire. Like, it's so weird to think where I was 2 years ago, just thinking that was who I was. Like, I just love food. It's like, I like food now. When I'm hungry, I eat, but I would rather do so many other things than to spend an hour or two cooking. Like, yeah. And I totally agree with like, oh, that looks like a cool little recipe there, but yeah, that would take a lot of time, and I just don't even care.
And all the ingredients, you're just like,
Yeah. I totally agree. And it's such a switch for people too, because we think it's just like part of our identity is, you know, wanting to do that. But it turns out it's actually our biology and our hormones that's making us a foodie. Okay. So, I wanted to ask, like, what's your long-term outlook? What's your future plans for life and food, and what are your future? Where do you see yourself going on this journey next?
Well, I feel like keto is giving me a lot more confidence as well. I remember talking to you in the beginning of like not wanting to eat around other people because this is not a conventional diet. It's not how society deems a healthy diet, and so. You know, like I've gained that confidence, and so I don't worry about people watching me eat anymore, whether it be keto or otherwise. And just in other areas of my life, confidence, working out. So you know, I definitely see myself getting even stronger, and you know, losing more weight, and you know, because that is still something that is beneficial, and I like to see that change. But I think eating keto, it's not that where before it would be like, I have to lose weight. Now it's, you know, I can go work out and just enjoy myself, or, you know, go for bike rides with friends or hikes and, you know, walks and things. And so just, being more active, I think is one of the things that I'm really taking away from this, and, not being ashamed of my body, and, just, you know, like I've started dating again, and just having the confidence to do that, and to invite coworkers to go work out with me, and, you know, things that I probably never would have done before. I'm having that confidence now. So
that is really, really cool. And it sounds like you just have, like, you're just filled with hope for the future and optimism, and like that you've got it figured out. Like, you know how to live your life now and not have to worry about these things.
And just the strength that I could probably, you know, like, increase my workload, help more people, and know that I could handle it physically, because I'm not exhausted and drained because I don't have enough fuel.
This has, like, changed every aspect of your life.
Yeah, it really has. Yeah.
Wow. That's awesome. Like, I mean, the, you know, I always talk about like the total transformations that people get on this. And most people just think about the weight loss, but it really is so much more than that. It really, really is. Yeah. Yeah. And it's, and then when you said something about before that you're like, gotta lose weight. You know, with that, there's a sense of like desperation and hopelessness almost. Right. And now do you feel like, I know I can keep losing weight. Like, I know that my body's just going to keep getting stronger. And
yeah, it's definitely not like that forward thought that's constantly on my mind. It's mm-hmm. just like, it'll happen.
Yeah.
It's okay. And I remember, I think it was an interview you had with Dr. Nally, and he said, you know, it takes time mm-hmm. for your body to, like, a year longer to recover from leptin and insulin resistance. And so, as disheartening as that can be to hear that, mm-hmm. you know, just know that if you stick with it, it can, you know, like notice the other benefits and then realize that you are really healing your body.
Yeah. 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 And the other perspective that I've been encouraging people lately is like, okay, so, you lost 30 pounds over this last year. When was the last time that you lost 30 pounds in a year and kept it up?
Right. Yeah. And there isn't that anxiety as well of like, oh my God, if I don't keep doing this, I'm going to gain it back. So mm-hmm. that going back to that, you know, like starving myself and working out 2 hours a day, like now I work out half an hour a day and like, I'm still strong and like, I feel really good. So just knowing that, like, I don't have to work out, I don't have to kill myself mm-hmm. to get the results that I want. Like you said, like I can have peace of mind. I can, you know, not hungry. Yeah. It's just, it is so much more peaceful.
Yeah. Well, it's that whole switch of like so much of, you know, I say so much of keto is like the opposite of what we've been told for so long. So most people think I need to lose weight and then I can feel good and then I can date and then I can, you know, and I need to exercise and then I can do all these things. But it actually turns out that keto gets to heal you from the inside out, top to bottom. Mm-hmm. And so then you get to have the confidence, the energy and the self-esteem and the peace of mind. There were all those things that you thought you needed that you'd get after.
Yeah.
You actually get them first. You get what you wanted first.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, any other tips or anything else that you were hoping I would ask you about or anything else that you wanted to share?
I think just the main one is just keep it simple. I think that's the biggest tip I can give for you is just keep it simple and just one day, one step at a time.
Yeah.
And just know that it'll happen.
Yeah. Nice. Okay, one more question for you. Surprise question.
Oh.
Maybe surprise. So if you knew this was your last evening on this planet, what would your last meal be?
What would my last meal be? Mm-hmm. Definitely a ribeye steak with butter and broccoli with what we like to call keto pudding, which is called mayonnaise.
Oh, you stole it from my son, the keto pudding.
Yeah, Kendall, thank you very much. We still call it keto pudding. Big ol' steak butter.
Oh my gosh, I'll have to share that with him. That might be his favorite last meal too then. Nice.
Yeah.
Delicious. Oh, where'd that cat hair come from? Anyways. Well, Megan, I am so glad that you came and sat with me and chatted and shared your story. I know it's going to inspire so many people. It's going to give a lot of people hope. And, you know, this, for so many people, this is such a, you know, this is a lifelong journey.
Yes.
This is not another quick fix diet where you lose weight and then you just go back to what you're doing. Like, this really is like life changing, and it didn't take you overnight. It didn't take you 2 months to get to where you're at or the degree of insulin resistance or leptin resistance that you have. And so be patient with your body, be so patient and just give it the time that it needs and just know that you've got the rest of your life to live this and enjoy all the benefits of it. So I really appreciate you being here and just really sharing. And I know you're not normally a extroverted person that wants to shout from the mountaintops about yourself. So I really appreciate you going outside your comfort zone to share.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you for having me. I think that, you know, like I said to you is, you know, part of owning my journey is to be able to share. And I think that to help other, you know, women, even men that are struggling and not seeing, you know, the drastic changes that they were expecting, you know, like that it will happen and, you know, There are really good things on the horizon for you.
Yeah, and the alternative is not what you want to think about. So.
It's such a relief not to starve.
Yeah. Awesome. All right. Well, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed our video, give us a thumbs up. Subscribe if you want to see more. And we'll see you next time. Bye.